wonderful person. I've known him for the 14 years that I've been at Texas Organ Sharing Alliance, because although he is a heart recipient, he's so much more than that. He is an awesome gentleman that I've had the pleasure of knowing, and now he works beside me at the Central Texas, no, the United Tissue Resources. They just changed their name 2 days ago, so give me a
As she gets older, she gets, so I put it on the screen for her.
Thank you, yes.
You're welcome.
But please help me welcome Mr. Lemuel Bradshaw.
So before I begin, it makes my head big, and I might forget what I'm saying. I think I'm done. All right, I'm Lemuel Bradshaw. I work with United Tissue Resources. We are formerly the Tissue Center of Central Texas. How many of you know the Blood and Tissue Center of Central Texas? I've heard that name. Maybe they've done, has the Blood Center come to Rouse High School yet?
Yes.
Do a blood drive?
Yes.
The bright vans.
They set it up in the gym.
I know the teachers remember, but I'm trying to see that these guys remember. Okay, so they set up in the gym, and they have those bright colored vans, and you go in and you give blood. Anybody give blood? Anybody? You have to be 18 to do
17.
It? 17? Okay,
sorry.
That's what I was thinking.
Wait.
So this room, we still have people who are under the age at which they could give their own consent. Is that correct? That's mostly freshmen here or all freshmen?
All freshmen.
All right, so here's my question, first of all. You're proud of them being freshman. By the way, there is no rule to my presentations except for one. There's only one rule, and that rule is that there is no rule. I know that you have questions in front of you. I don't want you to feel in any way shy about asking those questions, because I heard that it's going to be 50% of your grade for the semester. No, I'm just kidding. People were paying attention when that was said, and I weren't there. Okay. But I want you to feel free to shout them out at any time. Since we have a large enough room, just shoot up your hand and I will stop what I'm saying to answer some of those questions. Let me start by asking you one, because I brought you something as an incentive for answering. How many people did Ms. Segovia say were on this list nationally waiting for a transplant? I saw that hand in the back first. That's right, a little over 121,000. Now, I'm gonna put this on the honor system. Pass this gentleman. She looks at me like she's terrified. Throw that back into that gentleman. Okay, that's your incentive for answering. It's a basketball, it's basketball season. My beloved Spurs are in a fight right now to try to win. Who's a Spurs fan? Okay. Everybody else is getting points off. I'm just kidding. Ms. Escalon, how much time do I have left?
30 minutes.
Okay.
I would like to have some free time towards the end, so maybe 25.
Okay.
For
question and answers?
Yeah.
Okay. And since we're asking questions all through this presentation too, maybe we won't need as much free time at the end? Okay. So did you have a question? Were you about to ask me something? Okay. You're just commenting? By the way, you're on the front row. I'm gonna pick on you. I might ask you a question. I'm just letting you know. Alright, so first of all. Oh, go ahead. Question.
Let's say you have some disease, not that I have one. Why would you donate your organs anyway?
Why would you?
Yeah.
Because you may not have a disease that keeps you from helping all of the rest of the people who could possibly use one of those organs and or tissues. If you didn't hear Ms. Segovia say it, 8 lives, possibly 9, if the liver, can y'all see that line right down the middle in that liver?
Yes.
Sometimes, rarely, that liver can be split so that a small person, I'm going to pick on you since you're in the front row and you're small, may be able to get part of that liver, and then a large person gets the other part of that liver. And what that means in that case is that 2 people may have gotten the lungs, 1 each, 2 people may have gotten the kidneys, then you got the heart, liver, split 2 ways, a small intestine, and a pancreas. In that case, maybe 9 people's lives would be saved. Then, in addition to that, all of the ligaments and tendons that you see on the right-hand side, the bone, the skin, the veins, and so forth, and including eye tissue, might be something that affects the lives of people who receive transplants. Each person has 2 eyes, right? Well, most people, 2 eyes, so 2 corneas. Then the sclera, which is that membrane around the eye, can be split into possibly 8 pieces, 4 per eye. 10 people's lives could be affected. Their sight could be given back to them because of corneal donation. Even blind people, if they donate, talking about conditions that you might have ahead of time, here's an example. If you're blind, but your blindness wasn't caused by corneal defect or disease, you may be able to donate your corneas to someone who needs them and they can see. In a procedure that takes about 45 minutes to an hour. About 45 minutes to recover, surgically recover. We don't say harvest, by the way, anymore. Y'all hear that? Y'all are my frontline donation advocates. But they said, we don't say harvest for gifts like this. Harvest is what you do to crops in a field. We surgically recover organs, tissues, and eyes, or corneas, and we use them to affect the lives of people just like me. And now my story. I am a ripple. This is United Tissue Resources, our brand new logo. We are so proud of it. My boss has said, you make sure you use it on every slide and every presentation. So that's why it's on the slide. Okay, so this logo is intended to show that one donor that dropped in water. When you drop a rock into water, the ripples go out and affect more than just the place where that rock fell. The ripples represent all of the people whose lives could potentially be affected by your decision. What is your name?
Shayla.
Shayla, your decision when you're 18, or if your parents have, as Ms. Segovia said, it's okay for you to donate. If God forbid you were a donor, you could affect lives through that ripple. In 1998, I got bronchitis. How many people in here are athletes? Play sports. I played three sports in high school. Football, basketball, and I was on the track team. Did all of the field events. Shot put, discus, javelin. I was all state in two sports, all district in one. Never thought I would be sick. Biggest, strongest guy in my class, all the way through high school, all right? So, at 28, I then get bronchitis. Who's had bronchitis? It's not uncommon. I had what was called an opportunistic virus, obviously more opportunistic for the virus than for me. And it found its way into my heart and did its damage. So I was at UT at the time, or in and out of UT at the time, and I went to the doctor. This woman that I had just started dating and getting serious with got tired of me complaining about being sick, and she said, go to the doctor. I said, baby, I don't have a doctor. She said, go to my doctor. So I go to her doctor three times, and that doctor looked at me and said, you're a big, strong, healthy guy. I can't find anything wrong with you except your blood pressure is slightly high, and your heart rate is elevated, but didn't you say you drove up here on Mopac? Maybe that's what it is. So I want you to do this. I'm gonna give you these pills. This is a sample box of they're stress pills. What's the word I'm looking for, Ms. Segovia?
Anxiety.
You see, it's so foreign to me, I didn't even know what the pills were. Anti-anxiety medication. And this is supposed to calm me down. I'm from a small country town in North Louisiana, a place that makes Rouse High School and Cedar Park, or wherever we are. We in Round Rock or Cedar Park?
Cedar
Park. Makes it Leander, okay. So some people are gonna say Leander. It makes it look like New York City. And nobody believes in going to the doctor for issues from the head up. We don't even go enough for from the neck down. And when he gave me these anti-anxiety medication, I'm riding down the road telling my then fiance, you sent me to a quack doctor who gave me some pills, no offense to my friend Miss Segovia, that they give old ladies who sit home and eat bonbons and watch Oprah all day, okay? That's exactly what I told her. All right, three times I go to this doctor and none of the times could they find that there was anything wrong with my heart, but there was. And by the time I walked into Seton Medical Center's emergency room, my heart, after x-rays, was three times normal size and pumping at 5 to 10% capacity. May I? What is your name? Caitlin. If you held up my chest x-ray, my heart covered the entire top portion of my lungs. It looked like a chicken from HEB with the legs and the wings cut off. And the reason I know that is because I have my subsequent heart transplant on tape. Want to see it?
Yes.
I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. But you got a class full of crazy students. They want to see.
All right.
So I'll describe. I saw them reach into my chest and take my old weakened and diseased chicken of a heart out with two hands.
Wait, you're
awake. I wasn't awake. I saw it later on tape. Okay. Was I awake? I sat up and looked down like this. I said, there you go. All right. So I saw them reach hand and take out my weakened and diseased chicken of a heart and put my new heart in with one hand. You know, your heart is supposed to be, if y'all haven't already learned, a fist-sized organ. Ball up your fist, and that's about the size of your individual heart. It fits right there in your chest. And what that did for me is this. It allowed me to get back to a normal life. I had my heart transplant in October of 1999, October the 23rd of 1999. Within 2 months, I was back to work full time. I married the woman that was smart enough to send me to the doctor, and we raised 3 daughters. When I married into my family, they were 8, 9, and 15 years old, right in this age group, and they are now grown women. I have now 7 grandchildren. From ages 14, I have a 14, about to be 15. He's at McNeil High School, plays in the high school band there, trumpet player. Are you a band?
Yeah, I am.
Are you? What instrument do you play?
I don't play instrument, I'm a varsity choir.
Oh, okay, all right, so, all right. Well, you know, I now have a grandson about your age, all the way down to a 7-month-old. None of that would have been possible had it not been for the fact that someone made a decision like the one that Ms. Slagovia described. They signed up. Then, at the time that they did it, my family, we didn't even have the ease of going to a registry so that you could make your wish known. You had to literally stand in line at the DMV, snake through the line as it went back and forth, back and forth. Then you finally get up to the counter and the lady goes, "Can I help you?" And you've been in line for about an hour and a half, and there's a stack of cards. And you take one, or took one back then, and filled it out with all the other paperwork that you've been waiting to give to her. And you handed it to her, and she filled out, or she checked the box and said, "You're a donor." You now can do it so easily that all those cell phones that nobody, I guess, is supposed to have out right now, you can go online and in 5 minutes or less, actually less than 5 minutes, make your wish known online that you want to be a donor. Now, as Ms. Segovia said, you're under 18. You can't make your wish and have it carried out without your parents' consent. But here's why it's so important to talk to you, Rouse High School. Raiders, correct?
Yes.
Raiders?
Yes.
As a Steeler fan, it's hard for me to get all excited. But, you know, Raiders, here's why it's so important to talk to you. What's your name? Caitlin, why you are important. You guys, young people, accept ideas, accept information. You are learning now at a rate that you will never, well, hopefully you'll learn more in college, but right now you are learning, you're open to new things. Sometimes your parents and grandparents, people my age or older, Ms. Segovia, might say, "I don't want to believe in that organ donation stuff. I'm too old and too sick." Or they might say, "My religion doesn't allow me to donate. We don't do that, honey. That's not what we do." None of those statements are true. And the same place that you can sign up to be an organ donor or talk to your parents about being organ, tissue, and eye donors, it's a website and a database. Meaning, it's a database of info, or a website of info. All those things that keep people on the fence, all that stuff you may have seen on Grey's Anatomy. There you go, see, I knew, Everybody learns how to be doctors in 2016 from Grey's Anatomy. You know where I learned? ER in 1999. So I told, when my doctor said, "Mr. Bradshaw, that stomach ache that brought you into the emergency room today is really a failing heart and you need a heart transplant," I said, no. I walked in with a stomach ache and I know that you mean to talk to that guy in that bed next to me that's breathing like this. Sounds like Darth Vader, all right? Because I saw on ER that they misdiagnose people in hospitals and give them surgeries that they don't need. Because I watched ER, I got a medical degree from watching ER. You guys got it from Grey's Anatomy. But they also give you misinformation. How many people saw the movie John Q with Will Smith, where he held up an ER so his son could get a heart transplant? Doesn't happen, folks. How many people saw Return to Me? This is probably a girl movie. If the guys raise their hands, we'll quickly put them down. All right, Return to Me. Young woman, Minnie Driver, gets a heart transplant. From the wife of a man who is sad and later falls in love with her because all of the qualities of his wife he sees in this woman because she had a heart transplant from his wife. All right, stuff like that. I can't say that that actually happens. You what now?
She doesn't know that, though.
Okay. See, she's convinced.